Welcome back. We're glad you're watching the business show. The countdown is definitely on. Looks like, what, almost coming to the end of the month. And before you realize it will be June, so it will be half 2023. And the question is, are we still on track with the goals that we set? Or are we just guessing things into half of 2023? Talking guessing things, this is not actually guessing. This is real stuff. Yeah, we are talking mushroom growing. That is done as a side business or a business out of thought to diversify. Now, after COVID-19 ravaged several businesses affecting incomes, Violet thought for a minute and said, you know what, wait, this poultry business is doing okay, yeah? But right now, with COVID, a tray of egg is costing just about 5,000 shillings. So it means I cannot make money. And I'm telling you her story, okay? And out of that, she then decided and said, look, I have this 1.2 million shillings, which I think if I diversified into something else, I could make money. She thought real quick and she embarked on a mushroom growing business, starting with just 1.2 million and about 300 gardens. She is now making some good money. And she says, it's important that if you're going to diversify, you only start a business that somewhat complements what you already running. So this is a story of how to make money. She is now doing a mushroom as well. I'll see you after. I hope you learned something. Yeah.
These are our mushrooms. Why we started rearing mushrooms? COVID. In the COVID, you know what happened. Most businesses, the egg prices were up to like 5,000 a tray and were really suffering. And then that was my only source of income. So I have deliberately tried to diversify my portfolio, hence the mushrooms. So these are about a month old.
Okay.
So we are a month old in the mushroom
business. Okay.
Yeah, so we are learning along the way. These are due for harvesting. We'll harvest them tomorrow and send them to the market. We are learning where the market is. We are learning the best marketing strategy for them. So for now, we sell to wholesalers and also people who do order. There are people who order for a kg, 3 kgs, or order alongside the juice or hair oil or the eggs. Then we deliver to them.
So about how much does one need to start this kind of business?
Mushroom business is quite, is actually much easier than poultry to start. You need low capital. We started with 300 gardens. I think you can start with much less. Everything was about 1.2 million to start, and we have been promised that by the end of the 3 months we'll have gotten back our capital. Like I said, you need a mentor, and the mentor, we are moving alongside the mentor who has helped connect us with the market. He's come and trained us on what to do regards to the management, how to spray them. Yeah, so picking lessons from the poultry journey,
we are implementing them. You're talking about 300 gardens, and I imagine someone would think, so are the gardens?
This is
so
the garden.
Each is a... that's one garden.
This is one garden. So one...
Is it priced like one, or you buy a whole?
Yes, this is 3,000 to 4,000 shillings. First, we bought them at 3,000.
Okay.
Yes.
And what is the output in the along the way?
But I'm a good student. I learn first.
Okay.
The output should be 1 to 1.5 kilos of mushrooms in the cycle of the 3 months. Yeah. For each garden. Yes.
So what happens after 3 months?
After the 3 months, you discard. But by the second month, we should have put more gardens to ensure continuous production. Yes.
You talk about business diversification. Maybe talk to us about how important it is. Or should I put my focus on one business?
If all your eggs are in one basket and it falls and breaks, you're in trouble. That's why you should have different baskets, hopefully with different things and not just eggs. That's why I said we started, even the hair oil and the juice making, all those were started this year thanks to what we suffered with COVID. Because in COVID, the only source of income was eggs. When the egg prices slumped, we suffered. Maybe if we had mushrooms to sell alongside, maybe if we had juice to sell alongside, maybe it wouldn't have been that bad. So it's very good to diversify your portfolio. I've also invested in now in they call the insurance company. I don't want to say the name of the company, but like an insurance company where they invest your money in stocks, bonds, treasury bills, the likes. But if all your money is in one thing, you're in trouble. So I have deliberately sought out for financial knowledge. So I was telling you, there are many challenges, and all those challenges can go away if you know what to do. If you just know, if I just knew, maybe I would have been propelled even faster. But it's all good. What where you are, you put in measures to get better. Okay, so now my priority this year is to diversify and grow what I have diversified, and also seek knowledge on how to manage that money that we are getting.
Okay. So when you sit back and look at the mushroom business for the last 1 month, is it something you're looking on and saying, yeah, I think we might want to add more money in the future?
We have a few challenges with the marketing, but like I said, it's just a month. A month is a very short time to judge a business.
Yeah.
Yes, so I'm very hopeful, honestly, especially because it's not capital intensive and it's not labor intensive. So while with the hens you have, I've had, like I told you in the beginning, I used to work in the poultry myself without employees. With this, it is possible even with more gardens, because I get still help from the people in the hens, and they are not burdened as such. What the main thing you do, you get the spray pump. You get this spray pump, and you spray with water. The main input every day is just the misting with what?
Actually, I wanted to ask you about the space management as well. You talk about easier business to start. Maybe space management also. I see they are tied on ropes. Why is that so? Why not put them on the ground or something?
I don't think they'll thrive. Like, you get the mushroom from up here, the side, like anywhere. If they are now on the ground, they'll get contaminated with all this. Eh? And the output will not be as good. The output won't be as good.
Okay.
And they have to be clean. You're not going to sell mushroom with soil with that. They will reject. They will reject them. We are learning that mushrooms get rejected, and then you have to dry them. Yeah. Okay, and so the dried one, you're in losses, really.
Why so? Because I was about to ask, how much does a kilo, and would you prefer selling them raw or?
I think for now, people prefer the fresh one.
That's a refresher.
People prefer the fresh one. Now, you have to satisfy what the market wants. The business is not to satisfy you. Otherwise, if you do just what you want, you're not going to get money. You have to do what customer is king. You have to do what the customer wants.
Okay.
So for me, it's been rather a month of learning from the same person. I don't keep getting tired of learning. It doesn't matter whether it's the same person, as long as it's new ideas that are meant to better what I do, and if it's going to help me also grow my finances, why not? So from the poultry business, the successful poultry business, we're now into diversification, and she, Violet, is now doing mushroom growing, which is again something you want to think about. What kind of business are you running? And if all your eggs are carried, eggs literally are carried in one basket and they all break, what is your fallback point? So you would want to think of putting some money on the side. Diversifying is good, but it's important that you pay keen attention to the tips that Violet shares. things like start a business, a second business that complements what you already have. If, for instance, you need manure from here to use on the other plantation, then that is good. You realize you don't need to spend more money buying manure to put, let's say, on the vegetables or anything like that. So start a business that complements the other. Also, start a business that does not take a lot of your time. Because if your main business already needs time, then the second one you're starting should not now start competing with the first one. Otherwise, you'll be chasing wind, because at the end of the day, you'll be having two things, both demanding for your time, and you won't be able to know which one should I give attention to more. So quick tips for you there on what you need to know before you diversify. And that is how to make money with Violet Kakundake. We have one more story for Hama that will be running in the subsequent week. So stay with us to learn more on how you can actually make sugarcane juice. Okay, let's talk personal finance tips for this week. So part two of the four episodes that we're running on personal finance with Augustine Tamale, the chief finance officer of Vision Group or Near Vision. And today we're continuing with some more tips that you need to understand before taking a loan. Also, he shares on signs that your loan is on track. This is personal finance tips for this week.
Dear viewer, Augustine Tamale are my names, and we are talking about the issue of borrowing or loans. The last time we did talk, we handled the issues of whether we need to borrow, and indeed we specified that borrowing is necessary if it is a medical emergency, you need to save life, yourself or for somebody else. Whether you are improving your financial situation, then that's okay. And in improving your financial situation, you need to check whether saving money is the better option or borrowing. So you need to weigh the two. If you're buying a piece of land and it goes much higher, then you may borrow so that you save on the cost of acquiring the land. And we did reach the point of what you need to look at before borrowing. We mentioned that you need to look at the terms. And the first term was the early settlement option. If you have a mortgage and it's running for 15 years, if it's 300 million shillings, you'll pay over a billion shillings in interest if you service it over the 15 years. But if you settle earlier, you pay less. For early settlement, the term should read that you will be charged not more than 10% of what you've brought. So if you have a loan of 100 million shillings, you've serviced up to 90 million, the balance is 90. When you come to pay 90, you're supposed to top up with 9 million as the early settlement charge. That one is okay. But if you're being charged beyond the 9 million, then that early settlement term in your loan is fleecing. You don't sign for that loan. So look out and see that your early settlement plan includes a clause of only 10%, not beyond that. Not beyond 10%. The other matter that you need to look at is the interest rate. How much are you being charged per year or per annum, as people usually put it? The interest rate should oscillate between 18% to 23% here in Uganda, because we are charged high rates. I'm aware that in the developed world, the interest rates are less than 18. So in Uganda, we are short of financial institutions. That's why the few credible ones are making a killing. They are charging us high rates. But if we set up our own indigenous finance to look at as well as a nation, and that's where the savings and credit cooperatives come in to charge a lower rate. When this cooperative is just beginning, it should charge a high. When it becomes strong, surpassing a 10 billion mark in assets, members of that credit cooperative rework the interest rate and drop it. Because the institution is yours, you set it up to devolve. So charge a lower rate, less than 18 or less than 15%. Some cooperatives are actually charging slightly above 10%, and it's okay. You can see that even the agriculture loans from the central bank, that is Bank of Uganda, are low. They're less than 10%. They range between 6 to 9%. So that is a normal way of borrowing. When you charge the high interest rate, then your business must be doing so well with a lot of profit. Otherwise, this is a big financing cost for your business. And that's why I advise on early settlement, such that you don't run full term to pay all that interest. Let me tell you that the other thing you need to look at is the total of your principal and interest. So what is the installment you pay, monthly or quarterly? What installment do you pay? Add the principal and the interest. Look at that total. What do you pay per month? It shouldn't exceed half of your regular income. If you're a salary earner, if your net pay is 1 million shillings, then your loan installment with its interest, the principal and interest, should not exceed 500,000 shillings. Above 500,000 or above half of your net disposable income puts you in trouble. You will not have enough liquidity on you to run your life. So you're going to get deeper and deeper into debt, because in addition to this loan, you are going to borrow from a shop, a shopkeeper, you're going to borrow from your employer, you'll take salary advance if at all you are salaried. So you'll just get into bigger problems, and your credit scenario will become so worse that you'll be someone who is irredeemable, credit unworthy. That's the trouble you'll be headed for, and that causes a lot of trouble for you. So look out and see that your repayment installment does not exceed 50%. Now that's maximum, but when borrowing, try to go lower actually. Try to see that your installment is between 30 to 40%. Don't always go for the maximum of 50. Allow some flexibility to have a 60% of your net income with you. It will give you time to plan and live a better life. We'll continue from there next time.
So I guess those tips are pretty much clear for you that is watching. If you're servicing a loan, some things are more basic than you would imagine. Just do the right things. And it's important that if your loan is being deducted from the bank, for instance, you do not alter it, because it helps you somehow before you realize the money will be paid. And because the money is deducted automatically, you don't actually, well, you feel the pain, of course, but it somehow works for you, because for most people, carrying money and paying a debt is challenging. But if that money is cut off from somewhere without you handling it, it helps you. So make sure you don't default on the loan, because if you do, the interest keeps going up, and before you realize, you're probably paying double what you took. So those are tips that you need to pay attention to. We'll be giving you more in next week's personal finance still with Augustine. So make a date with us and learn something. Let's run you through the Forex then and money market report for this week. Well, that's a look at the Forex and money market report for this week. And before we go, just on that, Cipla on the stock market did post a drop in profits after taxes. So we hope that they can pick up. And for me, my hope is on the recent promise by the African Continental Free Trade Area Secretary General that there could be a better opportunity for them to take drugs from Uganda across Africa, which could then grow returns for Cipla. Otherwise, at the the 56th, yes, CEO Awards. We're talking insurance industry. The conversation was corporate governance. What can be done by insurance companies to have this more effective? Well, we wait to see how they plan to deploy this in their companies. From me and the team here, that's a wrap for this week. Thank you so much for making time. Feel free to get in touch with us. Drop those comments. Tell us what you think. Even after the show, the conversation continues on our socials. We'll be more than glad to hear from you. From me and the team, it's bye for now.